all be discussing about this particular aspect. And what is this aspect? That once the British government had decided to shift their capital from Calcutta to Delhi, what all did they need other than dealing with the architectural politics, other than dealing with the politics of visuals? So the material thing which is of utmost importance is the land. So land became a matter of great debate following this decision. Now, you must all be aware that land did not belong to one particular person. It was owned by a large number of people in varying degrees. So depending on the holding, depending on the size of holding, there were different categories. And other than these, there were also people who were landless. And so it does not mean that landless people did not have any connection with the landed gentry. Prior to the arrival of British in Delhi, Delhi was again very much guided by pre-modern or pre-British social system, where people were all tied up with each other. They were all tied up with each other. So landless would depend on landed for labor. So they would work as a seasonal labor, or they would work as as tenant, and they would receive. They would receive for their work either in kind or in cash, or in form which was understood between all these parties. So David A. Johnson, through his work, he is trying to draw our attention to how this all started changing when British introduced a new philosophy altogether. So when they had all planned to occupy land, they had to institute it. It was not just by sheer declaration. They had to think of a law. That is how Land Acquisition Act came into picture. So see, if you just stick to this, the phrase Land Acquisition Bill or Land Acquisition Act, it sounds very simple. But if you look at the impact which it was going to have on social structure of the then Delhi, it would open a very wide ground for debate and discussion, because it was going to impact the residents of Delhi in a very serious ways. That is why it took really very long, and it also took a great deal of consideration and deliberation on the part of British East India Company and the British government, to be very precise, because they were always concerned with the fact that they should not make the locals hostile while they were busy implementing their imperial schemes, while they were doing all this. So in so doing, they took every possible care they could have taken in the course of executing their overall plan. So in this land acquisition, there were a couple of things which I would like to discuss. One is, what was the principal philosophy which was guiding their Land Acquisition Act when it came to Delhi in particular and in India in general? So you must all underline, it's a very popular term, free market. You know what free market is? Are you all familiar with what the free market is, and how is this different from the traditional market? आप में से सभी लोग परिचित हैं? Is there anyone who would like to comment on what free market is?
Sorry, sir, can you please repeat it?
Free market. What do you understand by free market? Free market, free economy. Why is it controversial? Why is this term so controversial? Even if it is sounding so simple, why does it give rise to so much of tension?
Sir, in the free market policies, like there was no control of the government, like there were no rules and regulations of the government that were followed, and there was a kind of privatization also in the social sphere. So due to this, the people who were very rich, like the landowners, they benefited a lot, but the poor people, they didn't benefit from these kind of policies to which Britishers were strict.
Lavanya has something to say. Yes, Lavanya.
Yes, sir. Sir, I think you are referring to the liberal economy, as in where the market is a lot free, and the poor people are not able to enjoy all the facilities and all the whole liberalization process, wherein the market has been given the whole freedom to do the purchases and access the whole supply and demand. And
yes, very nice. Yes, Ishita, please. Ishita,
yes. So I guess Saurabh wanted to speak something, so let him speak first.
Yes, Saurabh, please.
Okay, thank you. So yes, sir, this free market actually is giving freedom to the market, like the prices are not pre-decided by the government. It goes according to the demand and supply. And sir, even though this term free market, it seems to be little, you know, like simple, but it can lead to very controversies, because sir, the big landowners, what they do, they like black market this, because they stock the grains with them, and due to which the supply do not go very much, while the demand rises, due to which the prices rises, and because of that they get a lot of profit, while the poor people, they face many problems due to this.
That is very much sorry for the inconvenience. Basically, you know, if you go back in time, especially in colonial time, when this idea of free market is materializing very fast, and this is very much guided by the political British political economy in particular, and European political economy in general, because they found it difficult to enter new places. And one way they could have entered new places was by proposing this idea. So this was a basically trope. This was a trope which appeared a very equitable, and it was against the territorial limitations, which would not allow other players into others' territory. So it was like all places were operating and functioning in isolation, without having a feel of connectedness. That is one thing. Another thing, entering into someone else's market was as good as breaching the sovereignty of that particular place. So there were no retail rules. There were no written rules as to stop people from outside. But there were rules which were very customary, and these rules were understood by outsiders and insiders. So the all these spaces were remaining well protected by unwritten form of the rules. And this, just a minute, is someone waiting? Is there someone who is willing to ask question, because there is a red mark? Okay, I will go ahead. So what was it like? So these Britishers were not feeling easy enough to conduct their business without using this trope that is called the free market. हाँ, मैं बोलूँगा इसको बोलते हैं ना खुला बाजार, जिसमें कोई भी घुस सकता है, कोई भी अपना marketable, saleable product, commodity लेके बैठ सकता है, और एक normal जो transaction होता है market में, उसके लिए वो engage हो सकता है. without having to seek permission, without having to abide by unwritten forms of the traditions or the customs, which were characteristics of pre-British economy in most of the places in colonies. So these unwritten forms of rules were giving a very tough challenge to the Britishers. So they were time and again reinforcing the idea of the free economy, free market. So that, and what were they saying? That if they make all places as a free market, there will be free flow of the ideas, free flow of the products, and it would integrate the entire market, and it would be beneficial for all of them. So, and losses could be averaged, and the profit could also be averaged. So there will be less loss and more profit. I mean, there were all, you know, they gave all the pros without discussing the con side of it, without discussing the downside of it. So this is how they were trying to popularize, and this very much reflected in their legislation too. So when it comes to deal with the land, because you know, when these Europeans were spreading, when they were imperializing and when they were colonizing all these things, all these places and people, what were they doing actually? They were trying to transform everything into commodity. For them, everything was marketable, everything was sellable, everything was purchasable. So they were reducing everything to this category. So land also became like that. So when it came to acquire land in Delhi for imperial purposes, they had to use this philosophy. So they started talking of taking over land from the owner by means of compensation. So compensation is basically it's like they would take away the land for the imperial purposes, and in return for that, they would pay them money, or they would compensate in other forms. So there were primarily three ways whereby they could have resolved this transaction. One was by paying the cash in return for the land. Other was by providing them similar size of land, or less or more. More or less sizes of the land elsewhere. That was one way, and other was by granting them revenue remission. So by freeing them from the liability of paying revenue towards the government. So this was the last form of compensation whereby they could have resolved this land deal, which was taking place between the owner and the British government. So what was it which became of serious concern in the course of dealing with this land, dealing with the residents for the imperial purposes, was that British people, this Britishers, they even though they were warned about consideration for the social and the customary aspects, which were deep seated in India, and people were very sensitive about it. So when it came to land, also evoked a similar emotion. It was not something which people were not connected to. So unlike Europe, in India, there was a social meaning which was attached to land, and it was very metaphorical. Because land did not only mean land which was meant for farming, or which was meant for habitation. People were very attached to their land. They would look upon land as a mother, and something which they looked upon as mother was not worth selling. I mean, that was something which could not have traded. So that is how people used to treat land. Other thing, people were not so much concerned about the money. They were more concerned about the past, because with the land they had memory, and that land they associated with their ancestral forefathers. So there was a connectivity with the past, there was a link with the past, and they wanted to hold on to that past. By selling, they were about to discontinue this tradition of holding on to the past. So that is why they had all remained very worried, and this posed a very serious and insurmountable challenge to the British officers. So they were taking a very special care in order that people who are nurturing such feeling would not feel very hostile towards the new British policy regarding land acquisition. So what did they do? They actually discussed a lot. And before they did that, they started embarking upon certain exercises which were again very uncommon in India. What was this? They started engaging in thorough measurement and assessment of the land. Earlier, prior to the British arrival, even if there was a tradition of measuring the land and reaching a certain form of assessment, but that was not in a monetary form, and that would not be very precise. So this lack of precision would give enough ground for ambiguities, and it would allow a great degree of vague relationship between the landowner and the actual tiller of the land. And also, nobody would come to know who the real owner is of that particular land. So those lands would remain unassessed, and they would remain exempt from the revenue. Who would be the beneficiary of all this? The landlord. The landlords would remain beneficiary of this. And these traditional landlords and zamindars, they wanted this relation to remain intact, because this was to their benefit. So when this measurement, new cadastral survey, mapping and assessment started taking place under a very serious guidance of this British establishment, they all felt very miffed, because this was going to change, and this was going to make this entire thing very precise, and this was going to become a burdensome for the landowning class as well. So this was one thing. Another thing which became a very prominent feature of this land acquisition was the enclosure. Are you all familiar with what enclosure is? And how does it impact the very act of enclosing your property? I mean, first place, what you do actually, you own up a land, and then you treat that land as a property, and then you single that land out from the rest of the property. You try to privatize it, where the communal link, where the communitarian link becomes very weak, and the enclosure aggravates this distance with your land and with the other land and with the other people. So it is like sharpness which is created when it comes to the the idea of the property. So the whole idea of property was undergoing a great degree of change under British government, when they introduced land acquisition bill, and when they introduced this practice of enclosure, and when they started dealing with a new series of activities like cadastral survey, assessment, measurement, and then trying to set a price for land depending on various factors, whether it is close to the railway, or whether it is close to capital city, or whether it is fertile. I mean, there were different factors, whether it is close to the canal, rivers, which would be responsible for varying price of the land. But these prices would be predetermined, so that they would rule out speculation when it came to, they would rule out the arbitrary way of pricing the land. So that is what they had all started doing. And so the land was also going through a redefinition, you know. So it was there was a kind of redefinition. Is it clear to everyone?
Yes, sir.
मैं ये बताने की कोशिश कर रहा हूँ कि जब दिल्ली को अपनी राजधानी बनाने का अंग्रेजों ने फैसला किया, तो पहले दौर में तो उन्होंने काफ़ी वक्त और काफ़ी अपना ऊर्जा गवाया कि यहाँ का आर्किटेक्चर, जो वास्तुकला कैसा होगा, यहाँ के डिज़ाइन कैसे होंगे, और जो दृश्य जो दिखता है ना, जो उसकी जो एक दृश्य की राजनीति है कि कौन चीज़ कैसा दिखेगा, उसका रूपरेखा कैसा होगा, उसकी नक्काशी कैसी होगी, उससे जुड़ी हुई जो भी राजनीति थी उस पर तमाम चर्चाएं हुई, उसमें काफ़ी वाद विवाद हुआ, और अंततोगत्वा एक मिला जुला वास्तुकला का स्वरूप सामने आया जिसमें इंडियन जो भारतीय तत्व ज़्यादा हावी थे। तो ये तो एक पहलू हो गया। जो दूसरा पहलू था वो था कि अब जब इसको राजधानी बना लिया गया है, जब दिल्ली को राजधानी बना लिया गया है, तो इसको भौतिक रूप से बदलना ही होगा। तो उसको बदलने के लिए अंग्रेजों को बड़ी मात्रा में, बहुत बड़े पैमाने पे इनको ज़मीन की ज़रूरत थी, और ये ज़मीन किसी एक इंसान की नहीं थी, तमाम लोगों की थी। हाँ, कुछ लोग बहुत ज़मीन, बड़े ज़मींदार थे, कुछ मध्यम वर्ग के ज़मींदार थे, और कुछ लोग ऐसे लोग थे जो उन ज़मीनों पर काम करते थे। तो ये जो आपस में एक ताना बना था, एक सोशल सामाजिक संबंध था, मतलब एक ज़मींदार और गैर ज़मींदार के बीच में एक अलिखित और संबंध था, और इस संबंध को कोई लिखा हुआ नियम तय नहीं करता था, और ये बहुत ही मजबूत था। और ऐसे सोशल संबंध में और ऐसे समय में ज़मीन को हासिल करना अंग्रेजों के लिए एक बहुत ही मुश्किल सवाल था, और इस मुश्किल सवाल को सरल करने के लिए उन्होंने क्या किया कि पहले सबसे पहले पूरी चीज़ों का जायज़ा लिया, सर्वे किया, सर्वेक्षण किया, और एक ज़मीन की क्या कीमत होती है उसको तय किया, और उस ज़मीन को हथियाने के लिए उसकी कैसी भरपाई करेंगे, जिसको बोलते हैं ना कंपनसेशन, उसके बारे में काफ़ी विचार ये लोग करने लगे। और इनको ये भी पता था कि ये जो ज़मीन के साथ लोगों का जो संबंध है, वो सिर्फ ऐसा संबंध नहीं है जैसा प्रॉपर्टी का होता है या किसी किसी वस्तु का होता है। तो अंग्रेजों के आने से ये हुआ कि जो ज़मीन का वस्तुकरण चालू हुआ, कमोडिफिकेशन जिसको बोलते हैं, दे स्टार्टेड कमोडिफाइंग इट। और उससे जो एक बार जब किसी चीज़ को आप उसका वस्तुकरण कर देते हैं और उसको बाजार वाली वस्तु बना देते हैं, तो उसके साथ जो एक आपका सामाजिक संबंध होता है, उसके साथ जो एक आपका इमोशनल जो कनेक्ट होता है, वो बहुत ही कमज़ोर होने लगता है। लेकिन भारतीय परंपरा में ज़मीन को लेके बहुत ढेर सारे धारणाएं थीं, और ये धारणाएं ही ये तय करती थीं कि ज़मीन न सिर्फ एक सत्ता है जो अजीवित है। हाँ, ज़मीन के ढेर सारे मायने थे। लोग ज़मीन को अपनी माँ का दर्जा देते थे, और कुछ ऐसी चीज़ जिसको लोग अपनी माँ का दर्जा देते थे, जो एक तरीके का दृष्टिकोण था, उसका बाज़ार में सौदा नहीं हो सकता था। लेकिन जो ब्रिटिश लोग आए, ये हर चीज़ों को लेके दृष्टिकोण बदलने लगा। काफ़ी चीज़ों को वो फिर से परिभाषित कर रहे थे, रीडिफाइन कर रहे थे। तो ज़मीन भी इसी दौर से गुजरा, और ज़मीन भी एक बाज़ार वाली वस्तु हो गई। और इन सब चीज़ों को लाने में जो उनका एक दर्शन है, आर्थिक दर्शन है, वो है जो उनका पॉलिटिकल इकोनॉमी है, जो पॉलिटिकल इकोनॉमी जो फिलॉसफी है, वो है खुला बाज़ार, फ्री मार्केट। फ्री मार्केट का मतलब ये है कि कोई कहीं पे भी जाके अपना कारोबार कर सकता है, उसमें किसी तरह की बाधा नहीं होनी चाहिए। उससे क्या होगा कि सब बाज़ार आपस में जुड़ जाएंगे, और आपस में जो भी एक दूसरे की कमी होगी उसकी पूर्ति करेंगे, और जो और एक मार्केट छोटा ना होकर बहुत बड़ा हो जाएगा और उससे बहुत फायदे होंगे। तो इसकी जितने भी सकारात्मक पहलू थे उस पर बहुत गौर करते हुए इसको काफ़ी थ्रस्ट दिया इसने, और जितने भी उनकी औपनिवेशिक जगह थे जैसे इंडिया जैसे वहाँ पे इसको इन्होंने लाया। तो दिल्ली एक केस है जहाँ पे जमीन अधिग्रहण को लेके इस तरह के पहलू पे काफ़ी जोर दिया गया, और अपने जो उनकी जो पॉलिसी थी उसको कामयाब बनाया गया। अब कंपनसेशन को लेके उन्होंने सोचा कि कैसे कंपनसेट किया जाए। ऐसा तो है नहीं कि आप साधारण तौर पे जाएंगे और बोलेंगे कि हम आपकी ज़मीन चाहते हैं और आप पैसा ले लीजिए और चले जाइए, ये इतना आसान मुद्दा नहीं था। इसमें बहुत ढेर सारा निगोशिएशन था और ये एक सामाजिक संबंध को बदलने जैसा था, क्योंकि लोगों को उनकी ज़मीन को ले लेना एक बेदखल करने के बराबर था। सो पीपल वर बिकमिंग डिसपोजेस्ड, और जो कंपनसेशन था वो ये तय कर पाना कि जो भरपाई होगी वो कोरिस्पोंड करेगा लॉस को। कहने का मतलब है कि मान लीजिए किसी के पास एक एकड़ ज़मीन है, यदि आप उसको दो एकड़ ज़मीन कहीं और दिला देते हैं तो ये ज़रूरी नहीं है कि वो न्यूमेरिकली तो दो एकड़ है, हाँ सांख्यिकी तौर पे वो तो दुगुना है, लेकिन दोनों का जो मीनिंग है आप उसको इक्वेट नहीं कर सकते हैं। हाँ दोनों को इक्वेट नहीं कर सकते हैं, और ब्रिटिश इस चीज़ को लेके काफ़ी परेशान थे। देवर वेरी वरीड कि ये जो पूरा जो कंपनसेशन है ये जो देंगे दैट वॉज एक्चुअली गोइंग टू सेट ए वेरी स्ट्रॉन्ग प्रेसिडेंट फॉर द एंटायर इंडिया। एंड सो सम ऑफ द ऑफिसर्स यू वुड कम अक्रॉस इन द यू नो कोर्स ऑफ रीडिंग दिस पर्टिकुलर आर्टिकल देवर इन फेवर ऑफ ग्रांटिंग देम डबल द अमाउंट ऑफ कंपनसेशन। जस्ट गिव मी वन मिनट। Are you all able to follow me?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
तो क्या हुआ कि लैंड अधिग्रहण को लेके एक नया कानून बना, और इसको कामयाब बनाने के लिए हाँ टू मेक देयर पॉलिसी सक्सेसफुल दे स्टार्टेड इन्वॉल्विंग इंडियंस एंड दे वुड टेक वेरी गुड केयर ऑफ देम। विदाउट इन्वॉल्विंग इंडियन इट वुड नॉट हैव बीन पॉसिबल फॉर देम टू मेक देयर पॉलिसी सक्सेसफुल एंड दिस टुक प्रिटी लॉन्ग एंड इट वॉज वेरी अनईजी फॉर देम। So, what do you think, you know, how was social relation going to be impacted when they, you know, conceived of this land acquisition? How is enclosure, you think, going to become very instrumental in changing social relationship? What do you understand by enclosure? You know what enclosure is? Now it has become very common. I mean, now, you know, because we are living in a time where we have all developed a very deep attachment for the enclosure. So whenever we buy a property, what do we do in the first place? We try to raise a fence. So that fence is basically a tradition which was carried from the Europe. Would you like to throw some light? Is there anyone who would like to comment on the idea of enclosure? Where is this idea of enclosure coming from, and what is it, and why is this going to create a very serious problem in India when it comes to the idea of property? What do you think? Is there anyone who would like to say? No? Ishita? Yes, Gunjan.
Yes, sir.
So, today also we see that the lands are often enclosed by the government for public purposes, for the construction of highway or national highways or anything. Like all the shops or the houses that comes in the way, they are like enclosed. And then later on, the like the people are compensated also for the property, but the compensation that is given is very less. And also like in the earlier, right to property was a fundamental right, but now it has been removed from that list. Today there is no right to compensation also. Like, it is not necessary that the government will provide you the compensation money. And even if the government gives that money, then the money is very less when compared to the property that gets enclosed.
Yes, yes, that is very much. Yes, Lavanya.
So, are you talking about the enclosure as in like where there is a barrier, or that area where they have surrounded it with a barrier to protect it from outsiders or something like that? Is that what?
Exactly. Yeah, that is what I mean, actually. You know, because you must have heard about the trespass rule. Trespass?
Yes, sir. So that's what I was going to say, that enclosure is kind of a barrier that protects your area from outsiders. And this concept was developed by Britishers. And the St. George Fort in Madras was like kind of an example of that, where they had built that fort so that they could separate their housing from the Indian ones, and they could create a very visible barrier and protect their area and develop it and not the Indian part of that particular place.
Yes, yes. So that is what was happening. See, the Khula market, jo bol raha na, Khula Bazaar, in the name of free market, they came to India, they started encroaching with reference to the idea which was very abstract, the free market. And then they created a rule. They created a rule. They treated the land as a property. And by measuring, they made it very precise. That measurement was very precise, very precise. I mean, it was based on a very sharp precision. So if you are owning 1 square feet of land, you cannot go beyond that. And nobody can come into your land. But earlier, it was a very fluid concept. I mean, people were not so much worried about this kind of transgression. There was no rule as such, trespass. So this all was, colonial import. And it was all now becoming part of everyday life as they were consolidating their foothold in places wherever they were actually settling down. So Delhi also became part of this new trend. So this government, after they would acquire the land or the territories, they would actually, they fence it. They will fence it and through the land records paper, because in Delhi state archives, which houses, paper related to the land records from the colonial time, when Delhi was ruled by the commissioner and the, deputy chief commissioner. So you will find plenty of papers related to the, the land records. And in that land records, you will come across all these, phrases, which are very legal phrases, like, trespass and, the fencing and then encroachment. I mean, there are a series of, terminologies which became, part of this land-related deal. And this came along with the British redefinition of the land and the property. When they started acquiring, they ensured that nobody is trying to encroach. So the very people who were entitled to their land, they were all turned out. So these Britishers who came under the, pretext of benefits of the free market, they now became the owner of this land. And in this deal, it had different impact on a different class of Delhi residents. So some of people, it was not that everybody was at loss. While this was all happening, it was not possible for British to snatch their land just by referring to the law. It certainly meant a great scope for the negotiation. So those who could negotiate well, they managed to leverage they manage to leverage a larger profit, larger sum of profit, whereas those who could not negotiate, who fell under the weight of the pressure, they relocated, they were all resettled elsewhere outside Delhi. So when it comes to the resettlement, places like, you know, the Karnal, Rohtak, and places which were falling alongside the canal, irrigatable, these were the places which were arable. So this is where they were going to be resettled. So some of them registered, and some of them who were given cash in return for their land, they could not rebuy land. Why they could not rebuy land? They could not restore their previous social position or economic position, because this very period was also visited by a series of famine and the droughts. In this condition, under these circumstances, these people could not consider buying land to resettle. They had to reconfigure their necessities. They had to prioritize their survival. So they ended up money which they had received as compensation. So many people became landless. Not this. Furthermore, they later on had to seek debt from the Britishers and also from people who were Indians. So many landed class who were traditionally agriculturists had now become money lending class, because they took advantage of these people and they started lending. So these people became highly indebted. That is one thing. Another thing, some people under the pressure of the drought and the famine had to mortgage their land. Had to mortgage their land for the money, for the debt. So in the event of success to repay that debt, they were promised that their land would be redeemed. But a large number of people who had mortgaged their land under circumstances, a majority of them could not redeem. They just ended up their money, and they could not arrange the repayment, and their land was taken away. And people who were seasonal laborers in this entire social relations, they were not incorporated into their discussion. I mean, what would happen to them? Because their very life was dependent upon a particular kind of economy. So for example, large number of chamars and kanjars, nomadic tribes who used to visit Delhi and who used to work here on a short-term basis for a short spell of time, and they would go back to places where they would come back from. So these people's life was very much dependent on a particular form of economy. So when these Britishers came, they just devastated everything. In the name of this free economy, free market, they just tinkered with it and nothing remained the same. So when this was all happening, they were not considered at all. I mean, this in entire discussion, there was no attention to a large number of people who were landless, who were nomadic, and who were of different caste, whose very livelihood was dependent upon a particular kind of socio-economic relationship. So this was all going to change in a very big way, which might have benefited some Indians, and it certainly benefited Britishers, but it worked to the disadvantage of a large number of people who were also part of a social configuration, which was in existence prior to all this, which had started happening under the aegis of British government. एक बार मैं हिंदी में बोलना चाहूँगा कि ये जो एनक्लोजर मूवमेंट उन्होंने लाया, जो ज़मीन अधिग्रहण का जो कानून लाया और जो भरपाई करने के जो तमाम जो तरीके हैं, इस तरह की चीज़ें लाएँ, और जो यूरोपियन धरातल पर जो खुले बाजार की जो चर्चा करते थे, जब उसको यहाँ पे लाए, इन सब के बदौलत और कुछ भारतीय लोगों की मदद से जो बिचौलिए का काम किए, और कुछ ताकतवर जमींदार की मदद से उनके बदौलत जो इन्होंने ये पूरा स्कीम सेट किया, अपने इस नए नीति को इन्होंने कामयाबी का रूप दिया और काफ़ी सफल रहे जमीन को, जमीन के अधिग्रहण में, और इससे काफ़ी लोग अपने ज़मीन से बेदखल हो गए। और जब उनको लगा कि इस पैसे से जो उनको कंपनसेशन के तौर पे मिला है वो फिर से ज़मीन खरीदेंगे और एक सामान्य ज़िंदगी की शुरुआत करेंगे, लेकिन ऐसा हुआ नहीं, क्योंकि जल्द ही क्या हुआ, दुर्भाग्य का मुद्दा था, विषय था कि काफ़ी सूखा पड़ा और काफ़ी आपदा आ गई जिसमें उनके पैसे खर्चे हो गए, उनके जिंदा रहने के लिए खाने पीने में खर्चा हो गए, और कुछ लोगों ने तो अपनी ज़मीन को रेहन पे दे दिया ये उम्मीद से कि जब एक बार अच्छा सामान्य मौका आएगा तो वो फिर से अपने ज़मीन को वापस ले लेंगे इस पैसे को लौटा के, लेकिन वो पैसा लौटा नहीं पाए। अंततः ये सभी ज़मीनें अंग्रेज़ों के पास चली गई। इस पूरे दौर में क्या हुआ कि कुछ अंग्रेज लोग तो काफ़ी लाभान्वित रहे हैं, लेकिन एक बहुत बड़ा तबका इसका शिकार रहा और एक अलग तरीके की तबाही चालू हुई, और काफ़ी लोग जो रीसेटल किए जा रहे थे पंजाब वाले एरिया में और जो नहर के आसपास में, रोहतक में, करनाल में, जो आउटस्कर्ट जो डेवलप होने लगे, जो तमाम गांव थे, वो कंपनसेशन कुछ लोगों को मिला, कुछ लोग तो उसे लाभान्वित रहे, लेकिन सभी लोग लाभान्वित नहीं थे। खास करके एक जो सामाजिक जो हमारा जो ताना बाना था वो सब टूटता हुआ नज़र आ रहा था। क्यों टूट रहा था? क्योंकि अब एक खुला मार्केट का जो दर्शन है हमारे दिल्ली में घुस चुका था, और जो इनक्लोजर मूवमेंट है वो बहुत शार्प कर दिया। कहने का मतलब है कि जो प्रॉपर्टी को लेके एक बार जब उन्होंने अधिग्रहण कर लिया तो वो प्रॉपर्टी बहुत प्राइवेट हो गई, इट वॉज़ नो लॉन्गर पब्लिक, और उसको उन्होंने घेराबंदी कर दिया और वहाँ पे बोर्ड्स लगने लगे कि कोई भी जो इसमें घुसेगा उस पर कानूनी कार्रवाई होगी और उसका ट्रायल होगा और वो अपराधी तय होगा। तमाम इस तरह के डरावने कानूनी जो होता है ना, लीगल डिस्कोर्स डेवलप होने लगा। यस लावण्य, यू वांट टू से समथिंग?
नो सर।
अच्छा अच्छा, यू हैड रेज्ड योर हैंड, आई थॉट सो। एनीवे, दैट वाज ऑल आई हैड टू से रिगार्डिंग दिस पेपर। मे बी नेक्स्ट टाइम व्हेन वी मीट वी विल अगेन ट्राई टू discuss some of the issues which might have been left out today, maybe in next, and we'll try to discuss something new. But it is a very small article. I request that you all go and read. You'll find it very interesting. Is there anything you would like to ask?